So today I wanted to expand on the theme that Bhavesh mentioned the other day. He talked about personalized individual feedback, which is part of a larger concern of being able to offer personalized instructions. So have you heard of personalized instructions earlier? I had mentioned it as one of the 14 grand challenges for this century that the American National Academy has listed. And that shall be one of the research aims of the department over the next several decades, because we are amongst the pioneers in the country to work on blended and online education, and where it is possible to capture the learning behavior of the students and therefore create a model of the learning habits of students and accordingly provide a mechanism of personalization. There is a fundamentally different shift in the educational communication that ordinarily happens in the system. In the system, as you are aware, we have lecture hours where a group of students are addressed by a teacher, and then there are individual or group efforts in working on problems. So we are looking at this particular aspect from the point of view of shift that will happen in the educational communication. So how does this communication happen normally? You have lectures to we have seen several facets of this lecture into a large group, including stage fear, including ability to address people, eye contact, body language, etc. The main point is ability to explain certain things, giving examples and anecdotes, which makes it simpler for people to understand what is being taught. That is the basic goal of educational communication. The next set of communication occurs between the group of students, either individually or in smaller groups. Generally call it discussion, although it will involve collaborative problem solving or whatever it is. Expanded onto the group discussion would be the notion of a forum, where although the forum is visible to everyone, there are a few who are participating in that discussion forum and contributing to the exchange of ideas. It is normal communication. When we talk of personalized instructions, any known model that comes to your mind immediately?
Localized campus.
Yeah, so localized what? In the conventional setup.
There may be language wise.
Personal coaching or tuition?
Yes.
Personal coaching or tuition are good examples of individual communication. Ideally, this should be the form of educational communication, because as we already have agreed,
Every individual is unique and has his or her unique way of analyzing things, understanding things, articulating things, absorbing things, etc. And therefore, this personal coaching or tuition is nothing new. It has been going on for a long time. In fact, if you take the old ashram parampara, although there will be a large number of disciples, the guru would individually note every person and would be able to communicate with everyone individually based on both the capabilities and aspirations of that individual. But that is because the disciples and the gurus spent entire time for several years, day and night, all together. Now this is not the mechanism of modern communication, and therefore personal coaching or tuition comes closest to the personalized instruction then. I gave tuition as one example. Any other example that you can think of personalized coaching being manifested in our society today? Take the entire lifespan of a human being from birth to death. On what occasions or at what levels do you see such personalized coaching or personalized tuition, as we may call it, happening? Maybe sporadically, maybe occasionally.
Parents initiate.
So when a child is raised from the childhood, the parents and the elder siblings, they spend individual time with the child. Now, it is not just they spend time for the sake of spending time, but during the time that they spend, they try to personalize their communication, which intrinsically is educational, but it's not called educational communication. When a child learns the mother tongue, when a child learns to walk, when a child learns to coordinate hands and eyes, right from that time, till the time that the child learns to read, child learns to understand images, all of these, the child often receives personalized coaching. But this is not an organized communication. This is intrinsic natural communication that happens due to parenthood or motherhood feature of every individual human. So elder sister or brother attending to a sibling and talking to that sibling in terms that the sibling can understand is personalized communication. So parents is one case. Personal coaching in terms of regular tuition is another case. Anything else that you see? Yeah.
So guide for PhD thesis works or something?
So guide for a PhD or MTech project usually has personal one-on-one communication with these students. That is a good example of personalized coaching. So here again, the guide would know the strengths and weaknesses of the student and accordingly advise the student not just what to study, but how to go about studying it, how to prepare oneself, how to cover for one shortcoming. These are the things that happen. Again, these happen intrinsically. Is not the major purpose is not to give personalized instruction, but that is what happens intrinsically, because when one individual talks to another individual, the communication is personal. So parents is one example, guide is another example. What about friends and mentors who are not associated with technical guidance of a learning of a particular subject? Wouldn't you count that also as personalized instructions? I write mentor generically, but friend is an equivalent thing for a mentor. There is one issue, however, in all such personal communication. This kind of personal communications are guided by the intrinsic sensitivity and intrinsic desire, not so much by a lot of study. Parents do not undergo a degree program on how to give personalized instruction to children. They intrinsically learn or do whatever they feel like. In conventional education, however, such intrinsic sensitivity and intrinsic capability are inadequate. You need to actually ensure that people who train for education are themselves trained well. And that brings us to another category, particularly in the arena of sports. Have you heard of this category? Trainers. This is different from a teacher handling a class. A trainer is almost always an individualistic trainer. So whether it is badminton coaching, whether it is any sport that you take, you will have a trainer per player of a certain significance. And that trainer understands the requirement of that particular person. And that understanding is what prompts that trainer to give appropriate training for which the trainer himself or herself has been well trained. So you are aware of how the trainers are trained? No. Take sports for example. Are you familiar with colleges which give degrees in what you call physical education? Yes. These people become coaches in different sports. A coach is not a trainer. A coach is like a generic teacher, coaching or training large number. So you have a cricket team coach, for example. But amongst these coaches, then evolve personalized trainers who would train individuals knowing fully well the shortcomings and the strengths of every individual. Given this background, how do we map it onto the modern educational system to give what we call personalized instructions? We need a system. We cannot talk of an individual human being giving personalized training. Suppose, as I often say, you have 350 million Indians younger than 14 years or now younger than 18 years. Each one needs to be coached individually. Then you will require 350 million instructors. It is not possible. Logistics does not permit that to happen. And therefore, as far as human beings are concerned, there will always be a few people who will be instructing a large number of them, as far as human beings are concerned. And therefore, this problem of personalized instructions is not solvable generically through individual human beings becoming personalized. It is not possible. Although a large majority of Indians, which are more than 35 million, 350 million, exist, they have their own things to do. They are not available for spending their time entirely on personalized coaching. That is the reason why there are only a small percentage of the human population which constitutes teachers, instructors, etc. And they have to handle larger number of them. So human solution is not. If human solution is not possible, can machines solutions help? Can machines replace human instructions?
Machines can add to human instruction, but it will not completely replace human instructors.
So machines can
add to human instruction, can enhance it at the personal level. But people would still feel more connected if a human is teaching them rather than a machine.
agreeable observation that machines can enhance human efforts but cannot replace human. I do not know whether you are aware, but when the MOOCs fever was catching up with the world in the first, second, third year when it was expanding exponentially, there was a statement made by some very senior people at Google. We said that no human teacher will be required in 20 years. That was a stupid statement. Almost similar to what the great creator of large IBM machines said at the beginning of the computer revolution. Do you remember what he said? The world requires maybe 4 computers. That was the statement he had made. Very soon IBM became the largest supplier of computers in the world, manufacturing and selling 50% of all the computers that were ever sold all over during those years. And the number sold by IBM were far larger than 4. So that was similar to what the Google observed. Most people, guided by the common sense, not necessarily by a deeper understanding of things, like our friend here said, machines can enhance but cannot replace humans. Now, the question is, in which way can they enhance? So I want your opinions on how.
One is like machines can be available to the student at any time they prefer, whereas human being may not be available 24/7.
So available. A personalized coach or instructor or a tutor or a mentor will not be available 24/7. I would hazard to say that if a human mentor was available 24/7 to me, I would actually feel very frustrated. Because I would like to have a large moments of my private life. I would not like mentor to be observing me or being available to me 24/7. So machines available 24/7, can I say, on demand. That means they are available unobtrusive. I can kick the machine shut off any time. I can do so with a mentor. Not very easy. So the machines are available 24/7 on demand, which certainly is not humanly possible. But that is available. Availability does not guarantee any meaningful contribution to the machine. I mean, imagine a microprocessor 8085 is available 24/7. Big deal. That's also a machine. Yeah.
So another could be, say for example, a machine can, say for example, a trainer or something, the sprinter basically. So for example, if he has a machine or a device which is attached to his body and which calculates how many kilometers did he run, how did he run, and all those things. So the data which is being collected by this machine can be analyzed in a better way compared to a human mentor as such. And another thing being that the amount of data which the machine can evaluate in a short period of time, the same thing would be when the human can take good amount of time, large portion of the time to actually come up with good set of instructions. So that way machines can give better, obviously machines can enhance the, in this way, they can enhance the instructions.
So, in the healthcare segment, you are already familiar with the bands, that wristbands that people can wear and which can measure the number of steps that you walk, the blood pressure, all kinds of things, right? However, and of course, it can be taken for granted that machines can collect humongous amount of data. which is not possible to be collected by human trainer. And the machines, in addition, can also collect and analyze. So there could be different machines working in tandem. For example, an arm wrist bend, it may only be able to collect it, but using Bluetooth or whichever mechanism or a USB port, I can port it onto a larger machine which has software to collect and analyze this data. Now that is one ability which human beings simply don't have. The ability to sense, measure, monitor, collect, collapse and analyze. This is actually the crux of our approach to using machines meaningfully in anything, including our education. Now here you spoke about the machines collecting data which primarily relates to the physical activities of the human being. Physical movement, physical steps taken, physical blood pressure, etc. However, education is more of a mental activity. I mean, how many times we have discussed that the physical activities do not necessarily translate into meaningful mental activity. Suppose you are giving a lecture and I am sitting in front of you. I think I mentioned this, that for 1 hour lecture that you give, I may not be looking at you constantly. Even if you force me to look at you, I may be looking through you. I may be looking here and there. So my mind wavers. And therefore, any measure of physical activity alone is not a good indicator of the mental participation, which is what is required for educational purpose. But we are on the right track. We have concluded that machines are available 24/7, they are available on demand. Whenever they are available 24/7, they are available unobtrusively. A wristband worn does not stop me or prevent me or distract me from anything that I do. So it is unobtrusively measuring my steps, my physical activities and so on, which I can tolerate without it. Imagine if that machine was to wear a big rucksack which I have to carry on my shoulder, it will obstruct my life. So non-destructive measurement of physical activity or physical parameters is now possible. And it is possible to be done on a large scale, because you can have affordable devices. But coming back to the mental activity, how do you bridge the gap between ability of the machines to sense your physical activities? Perhaps I can put a separate kind of, not wristband, but a different band to every student. Okay, connected to some sensors on the brain or something like that. Unfortunately, we have not yet figured out how human brain works. But at least, if I sleep off or doze off in a class, I should be able to capture that. So supposing I am attending his class and out of 1 hour lecture, I am asleep for 10 minutes. My wristband will show, okay, Patak, you are asleep for 10 minutes. Worse, it will report to him automatically, Patak was sleeping for 10 minutes. But sleep is a physical activity which can help me measure. But what if I look through you like this and I hear your voice, because the voice I have no control, sound waves impinge on my ear. But I refuse to take cognizance of what is being said. What will you do? And not because I want to do so, but because my mind wavers. You are not able to get my mind attracted to what you are doing. In short, we are talking about bridging a gap in abilities to collect data. That gap is for collecting data which is related to physical activities and which can be done, versus collecting data related to mental activity. One of the most important things in giving any personalized instruction, whether by a human tutor or whatever, is the ability to get and give feedback. So if if I am your instructor, or I am a student, you are the instructor, let's maintain those walls. You would like to know what mental activities I am doing, and you would like to get this feedback from me, and in turn, knowing my strengths and weaknesses, you would like to give me a feedback pertinent to the particular subject that you are teaching me, that this is how I should proceed. Right? So, in short, we mean the mechanism for a teacher to get the complete picture of the learning activities of a student. So, what is the traditional way of measuring learning activity? Performance in a test or a quiz, right? All of us know that this is inadequate in fully understanding the learning activities of a student, because performance in an assessment could be based on several factors. So, I don't attend his classes, I sleep in the classroom, whatever. But he conducts a midterm exam for which I prepare thoroughly and I crack 95 marks out of 100 in that exam. Now, will you conclude that I have been learning very diligently throughout the semester? You cannot hazard that guess. Statistically, you may be able to say that a group of people who scored more than 80% marks were probably learning diligently throughout the semester. So you can only make conclusions based on some statistics, but not about individuals.
But if you conduct it frequently, actually
performance in assessment.
So in the read that you say better.
Good observation. Frequently conducted assessment. The trick is, how frequent is good enough? When I and Supratik took CS101 in a blended board, we conducted quizzes in every lecture. We clearly overdid our act because students were scared. The attendance was compulsory. They had to see the, in a blended board, they had to see the lectures which was okay. The class they enjoyed because we solved problems and we had discussions. But at the end, we had a quiz. At the beginning, we had a quiz. So how do you frequently conduct such assessment without demoralizing students? That is one. How frequent is good? Should you say once a week in a semester?
I cannot answer on that question. It could be different for different people.
Sorry?
Cannot answer on that question because, I mean, it could be an estimate that okay, once a week is fine, but it could be different for different people. As in, I would prefer to have like once in 2 weeks or two times a week, but the duration is something different. Say in 2 weeks I give one quiz today and another quiz like 7 days after or 6 days after that, the first quiz. So as in, I don't know, it could be that keeping the personalized, I mean, this could be personalized in the sense that I have a week and it's necessary that you have to give two quizzes in a week. Now it depends upon me when I want to give those quizzes, instead of someone imparting that okay, you have to give these quizzes on this day and this day. So that way a flexibility in terms of when you want to give the quiz, with the determinate or with the restriction that you have to give quizzes, these number of quizzes in a week or something like that. So yeah.
So I say with options,
a flexibility in terms of when you give quizzes with the restriction that you have to give is many.
The word assessment or examination instills some kind of a fear psychosis in the minds of learners. And to take the sting out of such fear is what is being suggested, that gives some options, gives some flexibility. Like for example, you have the fact that we count best 5 scores out of 8 quizzes. Now that puts people to rest. I can afford to do not so well in some exam. And the reason is that whenever human is being evaluated, intrinsically human is fearful of external evaluation, any external evaluation. And that is the reason why the reaction is slightly on a rickets. But you can build options, flexibility, whatever. However, I come back to my earlier question. Would an assessment performance necessarily indicate the complete picture of my learning activity?
No.
I will give you another example. In a traditional setup in a university where you have only a year-end examination, one exam, one paper, 3 hours, does it mean that the student does not perform any learning activity throughout the year? That is not correct. Number of students may be preparing only for that paper just few days ahead, but people do attend classes, people do discuss things throughout the year. There is some activity that is going on. That activity, however, is not measurable. So the reason why we concentrate on assessment is immediately measurable. Can you think of some other mechanism of measuring learning activities other than us?
So another thing would be like doing projects. That would be another way of learning stuff.
Yeah, project will actually, project is a mechanism to force a group of students to perform activity together, or to force a student to spend longer time in solving a more complex problem, which is not like a fixed time assessment, but an activity which has to be done over maybe a week, 2 weeks or something. Typically, you take a course project, you work many hours for that course project at different points in time, but you are still assessed based on how you have performed in the course. The problem is not with the actual activity, the problem is our inability to measure the details of those activities. What we are talking about, you see, this is a very fundamental difference. To keep in mind what you yourselves first said, a wristband or the ability to measure your movement, unobtrusively. I may be walking for 8 days, off and on. For half an hour I walk today, a morning, 15 minutes in the evening, tomorrow something. But this thing measures completely at which time, how much I walk is measured and is available. Whereas when it comes to education, we are talking only about measurement by assessment. So even if you take a project, it's important educational activity, everybody agrees. People learn maximally on the project. But can you decipher how much a person has spent in learning activities on the basis of the marks obtained by that student in the project? That is the problem. So what are the other measurements possible? In the world of MOOCs, a whole lot of data about an individual's learning behavior can be unobtrusively captured. For example, I am learning online. At what time did I log into a session? Can be recorded. How long was that session? Can be recorded. Meaningless information, because I can log in and start watching a movie elsewhere. But majority of the cases, it is unlikely that everybody logs in and then goes to watch a movie. No, majority of the people will log in and do something meaningful. What is it that they will do? So let us write down what all activities people will log in. Go to course. So let me read out a long list that I have prepared here, just off the top. If I am a student attending his course, but I am not required to attend his lecture, he has prepared a massive open online course and made it available on IIT Bombay campus. That course contains exactly what he would have normally taught me in a semester. He has lectured, he has written material, he has practiced problems which I am supposed to solve, he has online quizzes which I am supposed to answer, he has online exam. In addition, he runs a discussion forum. He has a set of teaching assistants with him. I am in Jharsuguda, I have never seen him in my life, but when I enrolled for that course, all of these facilities are made available to him. He has given at the very beginning a schedule of a 6-week course. Every week, he says, I will announce a quiz which you will have to do. Every week, you will have practice problems. Like all good teachers, he says, I will conduct 6 quizzes, but consider only the 4 best. Anytime you have a question, you can raise it in the discussion forum. Either I or my colleague will answer it. Maybe other students will also answer that. You have seen that what happens in the discussion forum. Now come to the concept of measurement of my learning ability. I am sitting in Jharsuguda, he has not seen me. So there is no way he can measure my physical presence or listen. But now tell me whether each and every one of these activities which I have written here can be independently captured by him in terms of time, date, etc. or not. And can he not collect all the data? Login, capture it. Go to course page, when I navigate and click a mouse, every mouse click is capturable. Where I am clicking the mouse is capturable. I open a PDF file. Now whether I read or not is not conclusively proven, but I have gone to that page. And tradition indicates that a large number of people who go to a page will browse through that page. When they skip out of that page, I know that they have stopped reading this page. Now they may go somewhere else, but whenever they come back, view a video lecture. Whenever they click on view a video lecture, I know on what day, what time they click, night 2 o'clock, morning 2 o'clock, whatever. I know for what duration they view the lecture. If they press the pause button, I can capture it. If they press rewind, I can capture it. If they press 2x speed, I can capture it. Then I go to solve practice problems, I can capture which problem I have gone to. How long did I spend on that problem? How long I spent on that problem may not exactly again be an exact measure of how much time I spent. But generally it will be true that I will not be going to a practice problem and then going somewhere else. Statistically, it has been shown that the data so collected does reflect, in majority of cases, a large majority of cases, the learning behavior of the student. How long do I read discussion? I can see actually which post I click on. So I can even notice, he can capture that Fatak looked at the pointer related discussions maximally during these 2 weeks. This is something which he otherwise cannot find out. Even if I was to be a personal student to him in his class, he would find out how many times I have discussed pointers with my colleagues in the class, outside the classroom. But in the discussion forum, he can capture that. How many posts I have made is easily decipherable. On what topic did I make those posts? How many responses I gave to the forum observations? How many problems I solved myself when somebody else had posted that question? You see, all of this information relates to learning behavior. And all of this information is capturable. You get the point? Now, what do you do out of this captured information? That we shall study in the next session, because this is becoming the most important aspect of educational communication in the coming years and decades. I started with personalized instructions. So let me conclude today's session by saying how this will lead to personalization. First, of course.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Does learning behavior translate into actual learnings which I have? As in, behavior tells me, okay, I study for so much hours, I discuss most of the time this, but this discussion, is that fruitful discussion or something like that? I mean, yeah.
A very good observation. Does learning behavior translate into actual learning? The answer is we don't know. And you are very right in observing this. However, statistically it is shown that a very active learning behavior results in better measurable performance in the assessment. Now, whether that is equivalent to learning or not is a different question altogether. What we call greater engagement hopefully results in greater learning. But that's your hope. The point I am making is slightly different. The point I am making is, currently I have absolutely no way of even measuring or monitoring learning behavior at all. Even assuming that this learning behavior has a marginal ability to translate into actual learning, but you will agree that knowing learning behavior is much better than knowing only the marks in exams. What we do with it is not very clear, I agree. But shouldn't that be an approach taken for future? To begin with, you have to therefore capture the learning behavior, which is now possible. So we make only one observation at this stage, as opposed to the traditional measurement resulting out of assessments and exams, based on which people have attempted in giving personalized instructions to people. I got only 40% marks, so he gives me a special extra material to read. Somebody got 80% marks, he gives hard problems for him to solve, etc. But that is based on my performance. Everybody in the class who get 40% marks are given the same material by him. Now he has a chance to observe that Fatak from Jharsuguda learns differently, this fellow from Coimbatore learns differently, and therefore he can suggest a mechanism to give personalized instruction differently. So this is a step in that. We will discuss the measurement and the feedback mechanism, that is what we started with, and we'll continue this discussion in the next class, which I will announce to be an obligatory class. People will have to write answers to questions which depend upon this lecture discussion and on what we'll discuss for our particular today. That will be an obligatory assignment which will have to be done in the classroom. It will be an individual assignment. Obviously, those 15 of you who are here will stand to gain, because one of the columns that we'll have to fill in that answer paper is whether you attended the lecture on 5th or not.